हेलो एवरीवन, कैन यू प्लीज कंफर्म इफ आई एम ऑडिबल और नॉट एंड वेदर स्क्रीन इज विजिबल और नॉट। ओके, सो इन योर कोर्स फॉर सेशनल एग्जाम यू हैव दिस टॉपिक कॉल्ड एयर पोल्यूशन एंड देन अ स्मॉल पार्ट ऑफ वाटर पोल्यूशन। सो दिस विल बी द मेजर चंक ऑफ योर सिलेबस, बट द कंटेंट इज प्रीटी सिंपल। So I will try to cover this whole PPT today. Let's see how far I can go. So you have been studying air pollution since your higher secondary days because you had this subject, environmental studies. So a lot of things will be similar. I will not go into extreme details of those things which you have already covered before. But at any part of the presentation, if you feel like you require some more explanation, you can let me know. Okay. So let's begin the air pollution. So what are the various reasons for air pollution? The primary cause is population explosion. When you have too many people living in a small area, that is basically called urbanization. So in urban areas, you will have high population density. So when you have a lot of people living in a certain area, they require income. So one of the major source of income of any country is industry. Okay, we produce manufactured goods from raw materials. So when there is extensive industrial development, then obviously you will have automobile revolution also. You will require people to travel from one place to another, to transfer those goods from one city to another city, one state to another state, and so on. So because of this industrial development, you will see pollution. Moreover, because of automobile, also you will see pollution. So these are the primary causes of air pollution. One is industry and the other is vehicles. So if you just try to ask yourself this question, you will also get the same answer. So the primary cause of pollution are two: industries and vehicles. Okay, so the Air Act of Government of India in 1987 defines air pollution as any solid, liquid or gaseous substances present in the atmosphere in such concentration that they tend to be injurious to human beings. So there could be trace amounts of pollutants, but you cannot call it air pollution at that time. So if it crosses a certain threshold, if the concentration crosses a certain threshold, then only we'll say that the air is polluted. Okay. Now, what are the major sources of air pollution? So, natural sources are pretty common, and you know about it: volcanoes, oceans, forest fire, dust storm, hot springs, pollens, spores, and biogenic sources. These are natural sources. How can volcano lead to your pollution? That you can easily understand, because there is fire burning. When the lava comes out, then they release a tremendous amount of gas. Oceans could also lead to air pollution. That's because there are many organic content in the ocean, and when it reacts with oxygen, it becomes carbon dioxide. Forest fire is pretty simple to understand. Dust storm will lead to pollution of air by scattering dust. Hot springs usually have some gaseous materials which comes out of the Earth's crust. Okay. So this is also similar to volcano, because hot springs, the primary cause of hot spring is presence of lava inside the Earth's crust. Volcano is also same, but in case of volcano, the lava comes out, whereas in hot springs, water comes out. Pollens, spores, and biogenic sources are various kinds of plant-derived materials, which can also lead to pollution. But these are very insignificant compared to what man-made pollution causes. Industry, vehicle, domestic sources, and area sources. So we will look into details later on. So domestic sources and area sources are kind of like how domestic at a domestic level, how can pollution be there? When you are using a chulha, in other words, an oven which is run using wood, then you can have some domestic level pollution also. Let's look into further details. So stationary sources are industrial power plants. Most of these are basically kind of factories and industries. Fuel combustion, coal, oil, natural gas, solid waste. From solid waste also there could be pollution. Some methane and various kinds of pungent smell may come out. Okay. Municipal incinerators, where all the solid waste is burnt. So these are the sources of pollution. Now, again, here if you look into it, here area sources. So area sources are like residential heating, coal, gas, oil, institutional and commercial heating. So these are not specific to one area, one specific point. Domestic area will be covering a lot of area. So from various households, you will have small amount of pollution, and that would lead to a huge amount of pollution when it is counted all together. Institutional commercial heating, maybe at various institutional levels, there are some kind of activities going on at a smaller scale, that may be, but it can also lead to pollution. So point sources and area sources. Now, this classification is done for stationary sources. So whatever source of pollution you are seeing here, it's fixed at one location. Whereas mobile sources are usually vehicles, because these kind of things actually travel from one place to another, right? So line sources and area sources are like this. Line means highway vehicles, railroad locomotives, and channel vessels. And here area sources are motor vehicles, high duty, medium duty, rail yard. So how are you going to differentiate between the two? I will tell you. So if you look into one highway, okay, so maybe imagine that this highway passes through a jungle. Okay, so in that case, what you will say that the jungle is not polluting the air, but only the highway which passes through the jungle is the source of pollution. Okay, so this line, railway line, highway line, becomes the source of pollution. Whereas in case of area sources, again you can classify the mobile sources in these, the vehicle specific, a vehicle, a high duty vehicle, heavy duty vehicle, or a railway, or a train, or maybe a ship or an aircraft. This could be the cause of pollution. So you are classifying vehicles on. Here also you are classifying vehicles, here also you are classifying vehicles, but there are two different ways of classification. Here the individual vehicles are considered, and here the roads and railway lines are considered. Okay. In stationary sources also it's the similar case only. Point sources are the individual units which are causing pollution. Whereas area sources are that this is the residential area which is causing pollution. Institutional or commercial area which is causing pollution, maybe an on-site incineration facility is available on a large area, that is the source of pollution. So it is area specific. Okay, so here this classification is only explained, natural area sources, stationary sources, mobile sources. Okay, just look into the picture and you can understand it. Okay, indoor and outdoor sources of pollution. Indoor means basically these kind of things, stove, then kerosene heater. So basically domestic sources, then mothballs actually emit a kind of scent which repels the moth, but that scent is basically a kind of gas, and that gas is not present in the air. You are adding it into the air, so it's a pollution. These are a very insignificant amount obviously, but this is how you classify the indoor sources of pollution. There are many other examples like asbestos, it also has a kind of smell. Insulation, heating. So when you heat these kind of things, you will have some kind of air pollution. Outdoor pollution is easy to understand, you know about it, because this is very significant and you have heard about it many times. About this, you have not heard much because it is a very insignificant amount of pollution. So here some ideas are. So how can curtain be a source of pollution? Because it will have a lot of dust mites, and when you hit or when you hit the curtain with a stick, you'll see a lot of dust coming out. So curtain can also be a source of pollution. So that's how you understand it. Okay. Natural sources. So this is just a picture to show you how industries can cause pollution. Okay, now specifically, let's specifically talk about all the sources of pollution. So how is volcano going to contribute to pollution? It will emit various kinds of gases like sulfur dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, methane, etc. Okay, so it harms the environment for a considerable distance from the volcanic source. A lot of area will be covered because of this volcanic eruption. Accidental fire. It could be forest fires, and you know how much forest fire can cause damage. You have been recently hearing about it pretty frequently. So what kind of gases you might have? Smoke, obviously, unburnt hydrocarbons. Various kinds of hydrocarbons could be emitted, because when it burns a lot of things, not just the trees. When it reaches to the residential area, it starts burning a lot of other things. So that is why you might have carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, dioxide, trioxide, all those things will be there. And obviously there will be ash. Okay. Next, moving on. Dust storm, usually found in deserts. So dust storm that entry in large amounts of particulate matter. So visibility reduction during major dust storm is the cause of severe highway accidents and can even affect air travel also. So basically the pollution is because of the dust. It will settle eventually, but during the dust storm it is going to cause a huge amount of pollution. Next, let's see how ocean can lead to air pollution. So ocean is continuously emitting aerosols into the atmosphere in the form of salt particles, which are corrosive to metal and paints. Now, those who live nearby sea beaches will know this better. It is highly corrosive because those aerosols, small particles of water, okay, it has a salt in it, because ocean water is salty. So when those salt aerosols deposit into any metal, it starts to corrode. I hope you all know that salt can corrode metals. So those aerosols particles, when it deposits on any metallic structure, it will start to corrode. The action of waves on rocks reduces them into sand, which may eventually become air. This is a bit insignificant, but this also happens. Even the shells washed up on the beach are eroded by wave and tidal action until they reduce to such a small size that they too may become air. This is also possible, but these are not significant causes of air pollution, but they cause air pollution, obviously. Okay. Other natural sources could be alkaline and saltwater lakes, then sulfurous gases from hot springs. These are also some more examples of air pollution. Okay. Anthropogenic sources. This is the significant part, and these are man-made sources. So let's look into it. So any substance in air that could in high amount of concentration harm animals, human vegetations are called pollutants. We all know about it. Some examples are nitrogen oxides, dioxides and trioxides, carbon monoxide, and then carbon dioxide also, obviously, hydrocarbons, sulfur oxides, sand or dust particles, organic compounds that can evaporate and enter the atmosphere, organic compounds, various organic compounds in your drains and dumping grounds. Those can become airborne when they react with air. Okay, that they form into various kinds of gases. They can pollute the air. So how can these air pollutants be classified? Let's look into it. According to origin, primary and secondary. We have talked about this before also. So primary pollutant means which is coming out directly from the source of the pollution. And secondary pollutant is those primary pollutants react with each other and they become a new kind of pollutant. Okay. Various gases, which are all pollutants, they react with each other and become new gases. That is called secondary pollutant. Apart from that, it could be organic or inorganic. Again, particulate matter and gaseous pollutant. The particulate matters are not gases. These are particles. Gaseous pollutants are basically gases. So this also could be the could be a way of classification. Okay, primary pollutants, you know the names: sulfur dioxide, carbon monoxide, hydrocarbons, H2S and H3. Remember, HC doesn't mean a compound actually. This could be actually, I will write it in this manner. Just a minute. CX. H Y O Z. It could be any kind of hydrocarbon. That is also a cause of pollution, and these are primary pollutants. Now, when they react with each other, new kinds of compounds come into play, like ozone. Ozone is actually formed when oxygen reacts with oxygen itself, nascent oxygen actually. When oxygen reacts with nascent oxygen, it becomes ozone. Now that is a pollutant. When it is present at the upper layer, it actually helps us, block the harmful UV rays. But when ozone is formed at the surface of the earth, then it is a pollutant, because if you inhale ozone, it will be harmful. Various kinds of nitrogen oxides can form. When nitrogen oxide reacts with oxygen, it becomes nitrogen dioxide. So if it is forming in this manner, then you can call it secondary pollutant. Peroxyacetyl nitrate is also another example. Sulfur trioxide, because sulfur dioxide is easily formed when sulfur is burnt. But when sulfur dioxide reacts with oxygen in air, then sulfur trioxide is formed. So you don't get sulfur trioxide directly. That is why it is called secondary pollutant. Aldehydes, ketones, and various sulfates are basically here. So these are your pollutants, which are also called hydrocarbons. Okay. Just a minute. Okay, sorry about that. Continuing with primary and secondary pollutants, then what do we have according to state of matter? Gaseous pollutants. So all those pollutants that we have talked about, these are gaseous pollutants only. Okay, so that only we will come over here, nothing different. But when we talk about particulate pollutants, these are dusts, smoke, fumes, mist and sprays. So these are actually solid and liquid particles. These are not gaseous. That is why we call it particulate. Very simple. If it is gaseous, then we call it gaseous pollutant. And if it is not gaseous, if it is solid or liquid, then it is particulate pollutants. Okay, try to remember in this manner. Then there are some of those pollutants are settleable because they will eventually come to the ground when their size is greater than 10 micron. But if it is smaller than that, then it will remain suspended. Okay, so you cannot remove it so easily. That is the huge, that is the cause of pollution, significant cause of pollution. So it has to be trapped actually using various techniques. We will look into it later. But when there is a dust storm, finally dust will settle and the sky will become clear. Not in case of suspended particulate matter. Okay, organic pollutants are hydrocarbons, chlorinated hydrocarbons, aldehydes, alcohols, etc. And inorganic pollutants are these. So how can you understand the classification? So the easy way to understand is, if it is a compound having C and H, then it is organic. Okay, I hope you remember when you studied organic chemistry. When it is a compound having C and H, then most of the time we call it organic. Whereas if it is not so, then it becomes inorganic. Okay, there are a few exceptions, but most of the time, if it is H, if it is a compound of H and C, then it becomes organic. Okay, then according to chemical composition, we can do the classification. So there was one according to chemical composition. That's what you're looking, organic and inorganic. They have done it in a different way also here. Organic and inorganic is okay, and then you have particulates. Dust, smoke, fume, these are not at all specific to a certain kind of chemical composition. Okay, so this is actually not needed here also. I will remove it rather. Because particulate class, if you want to use it particulate, then it's a different that comes under just a minute. Particulate comes under state of matter, so I will not consider it here. So hexane, benzene, ethylene, I hope you remember the names. So these are organic gases. Okay, criteria are the EPA office, Environmental Protection Agency, okay, Office of Air Quality Planning Standards has set national ambient air quality standards for six principal pollutants, which are called criteria pollutants. So basically, air quality is measured using these few presence of these few significant pollutants. We look into how much ozone, how much particulate matter, carbon monoxide, nitrogen oxides, sulfur dioxide and lead is present in the air. Okay, so based on this we judge the air quality. So out of the six pollutants, particulate matter and ground level ozone are the most widespread health threats. Because when you inhale particulate matter, it could lead to various kinds of lungs problem. Same in the case of ground level ozone. Okay, ozone, you never get confused about how ozone is beneficial and harmful. Ozone in the ozone layer is good, but when it is in the surface of the earth, then it can cause serious health issues. Okay, moving on then. Effects of air pollution, we will now talk about that. Just the thing that I have told you over here, this we will look into further details now. Okay, prime factors affecting human health are nature of the pollutant, concentration, how long you have been exposed to it, and the person who is absorbing this pollution, what is the state of health, and what is the age of the person. These things actually affect. Not everybody is affected in a similar way. There are different levels of effect. Okay. Some people are more susceptible, some people are less susceptible. Effect of air pollution on human health generally occur as a result of contact between the pollution and the body. Obviously, it could also go through the lungs. It can also cause skin rashes. So let's look into what are the issues that could come up. Dizziness, feeling sleepy, headaches, irritation in the eye because of some gases, nasal irritation. I hope you have heard this term, sinus problem. So many people have dust allergy, that is nasal irritation, coughing and shortness of breath, sore throat. These are few very much connected, okay? From eye irritation to sore throat, these are all connected. Because if you have one, you could have others also. Possible lung cancer and other lung diseases. If you are exposed to this kind of pollution for a very, very long time, this could also happen. Chest pains and increased cold allergies, okay? Health effects, eye irritation, nose and throat irritation. That's what we have looked into here. This is only explained in this page, nothing new. Some kind of diseases like chronic pulmonary diseases, which are actually occurring in the lungs. So like bronchitis, asthma, are aggravated by a high concentration of SO2 and NO2. We don't even think about these. We are mainly familiar with carbon dioxide, but these are also primary reason for bronchitis and asthma. Okay. Some more. This slide is basically a continuation of slide number 35. So carbon monoxide combines with hemoglobin in the blood, and consequently increases stress on those suffering from cardiovascular and pulmonary diseases. So it can lead to shortness of breath also. So hydrogen fluoride, HF, it causes disease of bone, fluorosis, and mottling of teeth. So these kind of things may also happen. But it happens when you are exposed to this kind of pollution for a very long time. But there may not be significant effect otherwise, but effect is obviously going to. Carcinogenic agents also cause cancer. Many of these gases are carcinogenic. Now, dust particles cause respiratory diseases, obviously. Silicosis, asbestosis, etc. result from specific dust. So it cannot be because of the sand dust, but there could be many other kind of dusts that can cause silicosis and asbestosis. So asbestosis is actually occurring because of the exposure to asbestos. Asbestos ceilings are present actually in many places. Then silicon is present in sand. Because of sand, there could be silicosis. Certain heavy metals like lead may enter the body, lungs, and cause poisoning. This may also happen because of the presence of lead. Okay, so these few slides that I've talked now, 1, 2, 3, and 4, these are human effects. Now let's talk into how air pollution can affect various kinds of materials like buildings, etc. So the most common example you have already heard about is about the Taj Mahal. Because of various kinds of air pollution, the marble of Taj Mahal has started to corrode. Okay, so why does that happen? You can see here, metals, building materials, rubber, elastomers, these kind of things get affected by air pollution. And what kind of damages could happen? Corrosion. Okay. It will start to corrode. You can see some small holes coming, abrasion. The surface could start getting abraded. Abraded means when you rub something, then the friction causes deterioration of the surface. That is called abrasion. Some kind of unwanted material can get deposited. There could be direct or indirect chemical attack also, which can lead to these kind of damages. So the intensity of damage depends upon moisture, temperature, sunlight, air, and nature and concentration of the pollutant. Obviously, how much corrosion is happening, that will also depend on these factors. Okay. So the questions could be coming, could come from these kind of points actually. What are the various factors which can lead to air pollution? So the intensity of damage, what are the factors that depends or affects the intensity of damage? These points could be your questions. Now, we have talked about human health, we have talked about materials. Now let's look into effect on animals. Okay, so the process by farm animals get poisoned is divided into two steps: accumulation of airborne containments on vegetation, so vegetation could get affected, and when the vegetation is affected and when the farm animals consume this vegetation, they can get poisoned. And direct poisoning of elements when they eat the contaminated vegetation, that can. Fluorine, arsenic, and lead are the main pollutants which can cause damage to livestock when they eat those affected vegetation. Another way is when animals inhale polluted gases, they can suffocate and die. This may also happen. Now let's look into the damage on vegetation. What kind of damage it may have on plants? So if you look into these pictures, you can see how the color has changed. Okay, I have seen this at my home also. Sometimes the color of the leaves actually get changed. The reason being the damage in the form of visual effects such as chlorotic marking, banding, silvering or bronzing of the underside of the leaf. This can happen because of various kinds of pollutants. Okay, and obviously it could lead to reduction in plant growth because if it is not green, it cannot conduct photosynthesis, and because of that, the plant will become weak. So these are the effects of air pollutants on various kinds of entity. We have one more, directly how it can affect the environment. So these kind of things may happen. Acid rain, you all know what acid rain is. Various kinds of gases, when it reacts with water, it becomes acid. And then it comes down to the earth. Now this is another way you can interpret the effect of air pollution on environment. Greenhouse gas, the whole atmosphere can get heated up. Ozone layer can start to deplete, and if there is ozone layer depletion, there will be effect of harmful ultraviolet rays on actually buildings as well as people also, because it could lead to skin cancer also. Photochemical smog, so smog could come up. I will show you a picture now, and global warming. So this is called photochemical smog. And this could happen because of the presence of various kinds of air pollutants. Now, this is actually a video, so let's watch it. So, you won't require the video, the audio, so you can just simply look into it. So this is just a demonstration of how acid rain effects and what are the causes of it. Next, now that we have looked into various kinds of effects of air pollution on animal, human, materials, and environment, now we will look into how we can control air pollution. Air pollution control methods. So these are three kinds of things that we can do basically. Source correction methods. So the source of air pollution could itself be revamped so that less amount of pollution happens. Maybe instead of using a petrol vehicle, you can go for electric vehicle. Just an example. Then you are using a certain kind of technology in industry. You can use better technology so that pollution can be reduced. So these are source correction. For absorption of the pollution, you can go for vegetation also. So vegetation will also help in absorbing the air pollution. And zoning means keep the industrial zone away from the residential zone. So this is another way of segregating the zones, and so that one zone is not affected by the other. The industrial zone could have pollution, but it will not directly affect the residential zones. Okay, this is another way. Source correction methods. This is the most, you know, significant part actually. So if you can try to curtail pollution at the source itself, then you don't have to much worry about point number 2 and 3. Okay. So what is source correction? It can be done by raw material changes. Maybe if you stop using coal for producing energy, or if you can reduce the usage of coal, then there will be reduction in pollution. Then process changes. What kind of technology you are using to burn it? That if you can change, then there could be reduction in pollution. Equipment modification, better equipments, improved dispersion. The dispersion of these pollutants into the air, if you can cut it, if you can check it, then also you can improve the air quality, or in other words, reduce air pollution. Good operating practices. If the operation technique is better, then also you can reduce pollution. Or maybe plant shutdown or relocation. You can shift it to some other location where there is not much people living, so it is not in within the residential area, and so it could help you cause less effect to the population. The pollution will be there, but the effect will be less. Next, vegetation. This purifies air for respiration of man and animals. That is why in jungles and forests you see that the air quality is better compared to industrial area. That's because there is enough absorption power into those forests, right? Gaseous pollution like carbon monoxide are fixed by some plants. It can be converted to carbon dioxide also, and then it can be absorbed also. That is pollution. That is possible. Some species of plants depollute the air by metabolizing nitrogen oxides. So nitrogen oxides can be absorbed in the soil, and it could be turned into fertilizers. Plenty of trees should be planted around high-risk areas of pollution. That can be done to reduce the pollution. So vegetation actually helps. And zoning, I have already talked about. So industrial area should be far away from residential area. These kind of things you can do. Location of new industries should be far away from larger cities, and it should be guided by regional planning. So when you plan properly, you can segregate it. See, these are some examples. In Bangalore, industrial estate is divided into 3 zones, namely light, medium, and large. So in Bangalore and Delhi, very large industries are not permitted. And the location where large industries are allowed will be far from the city. Okay. Now, we have talked about one point here. process changes, equipment modification, and improved dispersion. This can be done by source correction. We will talk about it a bit more here. Air pollution control equipment. What kind of equipment can we use to check the air pollution? So these are the cleaning techniques are applied where emissions of once again, just a minute. So cleaning techniques are applied where emissions of pollutions cannot be prevented and pollution control equipment is necessary to remove them from the main gas strip. The emissions of the plant are passed through a control device before releasing into the atmosphere. So what's going on here is that before you emit the gas into the air, you cannot actually check it. It will finally go out into the atmosphere. But before you do that, if you can clean the air as much as possible, then your air will be less polluted. So the emissions from the plants are passed through a control device before releasing into the atmosphere. So that control device is actually instrumental in actually capturing or preventing the particulate matters. Okay? The pollutants are removed, destroyed or transformed in control device before discharging into the ambient air. So if you look into this picture here, how is it done? Gravitational settling chamber, maybe using gravity some of those particles could be brought down. Cyclone separators, this can also be used to trap the pollutants. Fabric filters, if the air passes through the filter, then the filter will trap all these particulate matters. And electrostatic precipitators, if it is so small that you cannot trap it, then it is also possible to charge those particulates. And once you charge it, and if you place an opposite charge around it, maybe a surface having opposite charge, then those small particles will get attracted and it will get trapped into the wall of the chimney. So then air can go out. So this is usually done for in the cement industries and thermal industries also. So thermal power plants, they use this technique to trap the particles. So absorption, adsorption, condensation and combustion. So these are the four types by which we can trap the gaseous pollutants. So I will discuss these points in the next class because it's a bit tricky and it will take some time for you to understand. So the simpler parts I have covered in this class, the rest we will discuss in the next class. Okay, so do you have anything to ask me for these points, anything? So basically, in summary, if we look into it, so we have talked about, first of all, what is air pollution? And then we looked into, firstly, the basic description of what is meant by air pollution. Then we talked about various sources of air pollution. And there are industrial, vehicular, and domestic sources, but there is another way of classifying the sources. Then we looked into each and every type of the sources of air pollution, natural and man-made. Okay. In this slide, you can see there are natural sources and there are man-made sources. So we talked about all these components in each slides. Okay. We learned about how they are polluting the environment. When we were done with this, we started to look into the effect. We looked into the effect on human, animals, plants, materials, and environment. Okay? And then we just briefly started with how we can control air pollution. So These are the three methods. Vegetation and zoning are actually secondary control methods. The primary control method is the source correction. And we started discussing this source correction. And we are here. How can we control the pollution? Okay. So we will continue with this in the next week. And anything that you need to ask me, you can go ahead now.